In this series, our job is to wire the instructions needed in order to produce a Fibonacci sequence. To produce the sequence, you start with a 0 and 1, add them up to get the next result. Then keep adding the result to the last operand to produce the next one. This process can go on as users like. It's a simple problem, but it demonstrates a critical tool offered by a computer. Looping. Keep doing the same thing until told not to. Looping is computer's secret weapon in solving most real-life problems. In a computer, the initial data and instructions are stored in memory. We'll talk about how to get them there in the future. Now let's assume they're already here. So we need non-computing instructions to move data between registers and memory. The first instruction we need is a data instruction. It's used to bring the initial data into registers. Let's assume it's stored in the first memory unit already. During step 1, 2, 3, the data instruction will be fetched into instruction register, and then it will be executed during step 4 to 6. How should the data instruction look like? The first 4 bits indicate what kind of operation we want to do. First bit is used to indicate if it's computing instruction or not. High means it is, low means it's not. By using an inverter, a low bit can power non-computing instructions. The following 3 bits indicate what kind of non-computing instructions. By using a 3x8 decoder, they can turn on 8 output wires, ending the non-computing bit with the 8 wires. The opcode can power one of the 8 non-computing instructions. We will talk about them one by one in the following videos. Here, this particular combo, low low high low, can turn on the 3rd wire, used for data instruction. It doesn't really matter which wire you use for which instruction. I'm just following Scott's CPU to be consistent. Now, how to get these data instruction wire actually do things? It needs to move data from memory into registers through bus. But the computing instruction we previously wired in series 2 is also busy moving data through the bus. For example, during step 4, data will be sent from one of the 4 registers to the temp through bus. So there's a conflict in using the bus. Hence, we need to turn this computing instruction off by using this low computing bit. So these computing controls can't be connected to the sequencer directly. They must listen to the computing bit as well. Ending the timing wires and the computing bit, the AND gates output conditional timing wires. Now, all these timing controls are connected to the conditional wires instead. This way, only when it's a computing instruction, these wires will turn on at the right time. If it's a non-computing instruction, the low bit will turn off all these conditional wires, freeing up the bus. Remember, these 3 bits are used to choose one of the 7 operations in the ALU. Now, of course, if you're not computing, don't bother decoding the operation. So we use this low computing bit to mute these 3 selection bits. The remaining 4 bits need to tell the computer where the data is coming from and which register it's going into. Say we want to move data into R0, so the last 2 bits should be low low, getting the register ready to receive data. Initial data are stored by users beforehand, so users have to provide those locations through instruction. The 2 remaining bits are not enough for the 8-bit address. Data instruction uses a trick to get around it. It requires users to attach the data right after the instruction. So the data instruction takes 2 bytes, the instruction itself and the data. The benefit is we know where the data is without users telling us. Remember when we first start, the instruction pointer has the first address, used to fetch the first instruction into here. Then the pointer is updated with the next address during the fetch cycle. So this address is actually pointing to the data we want, so we can use it to get the data. So data instruction only requires the 4-bit opcode selecting the operation and 2-bit target register where the data is going to. The middle 2 bits are not used, can be left as low. Now let's do the wiring. First, during step 4, we need to move the address into memory address register. So we end these two to get a conditional timing wire. It will be turned on at step 4 when it's data instruction. Then we need to turn on these two. But they are also wired for instruction fetching. So we need OR gate. Connect the timing wire to send address from instruction pointer to memory address register. So during step 4, the address will be here, selecting the cell. But don't forget to update this instruction address with the next one. Hence, in the meantime, we increase the address by 1 and store the updated address into the ACC. Then step 5, we turn on the memory unit to send data into the register. So we get the conditional wire first, then connect RAM and register to send and receive data. Now during step 5, data will be here. Last step, update instruction pointer. We move the address from ACC into instruction pointer. So we extend the step wire, getting a conditional wire for step 6. Connect ACC and instruction pointer. So at the end of the data instruction, the instruction pointer is updated with the next address. It's used to fetch the next instruction. With these two instructions at hand, we can start writing the program to do first round of computing. We will see that in the next video. And we will also see other two instructions needed to do the second round of computing.